Greetings, space friends, and welcome to Stellaris! Yes, if you've any interest in Paradox games at all, you will have known that this was coming out probably for quite a long time now, and it has finally released today as of recording this, and yesterday as of this video going up. Now, if you've been following my channel at all and my Twitch, you'll have seen that I did several hours long stream, but of course that's in 480p potato quality. Now what this video is going to be, it's not the review, this is going to be a basic introduction to setting up a species and what the various game options mean, and then I will try and touch on some of the more important game mechanics. I am going to do a proper review of this, but I'm basically waiting for some information back from Paradox. I will also say I have encountered a few bugs here and there, so it's a complicated game. There's a lot going on, so it's maybe not that surprising that there's a few bugs. There's also various mechanics, even though I've played in the couple of days I've had this just over 50 hours. I may have been binging on it slightly. There's a couple of mechanics I don't fully understand yet, because obviously it just having come out and myself having, along with others, having gotten it a few days early for review purposes, there's no wikis or anything that we can go and look up at the moment. So there's various things where I'm not quite sure if it's working as intended, to use the phrase from Wargaming. So the other thing I want to say is I'm actually in an interesting position because I, of course, am also giving some coverage to the revamp of Master of Orion, or I don't know how to call it revamp exactly. It's more of a modern remake, but a very faithful remake. So that's a rather different game, and there may inevitably be some question about, you know, which one is better. I don't know if it's necessarily a question of which one is better. I think it's more a question of what sort of a game do you want to play? And if you are already a fan of Paradox games, well, the answer is very definitely going to be Stellaris. But having said that, there are actually some interesting divergences from the usual kind of Paradox game mechanics that we're used to, or at least that I'm used to, having played, you know, EU4 and CK2 and, well, hell, the original CK, EU3, Hearts of Iron 3, and Victoria 2. So I've probably put in a couple of thousand hours across all of their games. There are some things I'm very familiar with, and so when I say that wasn't expected, well, it's on occasion some of those unexpected things have thrown me for a bit of a loop. So I'm going to start off with the new game option, because the thing you're immediately presented with is this. And they basically have a bunch of preset races for you to choose from, and they're all reasonably balanced. I mean, you can basically tell what they all are. They've got a little actual blurb, which it would be interesting if it had some kind of auto-generated blurb for the races that you yourself create, but it basically gives you some idea of what they are. Now, this might be a bit confusing if you are completely new to Paradox games. There are some familiar elements, say, from CK2 in particular here, in terms of these things here, which are basically traits. And you've actually got different sets of traits, some of which relate to the species themselves, others which relate to the kind of government that species has. So you can pick one of the preset ones and it will have a certain kind of gameplay associated with it, or you can jump in and create your own. And you'll note that the ones that are the presets don't have this little symbol here. Well, basically what this means is that you can, with the ones you've created, force them to spawn as AI controlled civs in games that you start. So I could start a new game right now and click the button which would force all of these civs to also spawn somewhere in that galaxy. Now, just the lit up bird symbol means that there's a chance they'll spawn, and if it's grayed out, it means that the game will definitely not spawn them in. So what you could do is you could create a whole bunch of custom civs, force them all to spawn, and without even the need to mod the game, you could create some quite interesting scenarios. Modding, that's a whole other thing. I mean, we'll come to modding at some point. But yeah, I'll go ahead and click the Create New species button, because I mean, we could edit some of the existing ones here. You can actually edit the presets as well, but we'll go with create new and I will explain the important bits. So a lot of these I'll just leave as the default, and the default is boring old humans. You start off with a list over here and it's reasonably self-explanatory. Now the important ones are really, this is all cosmetic stuff. The important ones are to do with the species traits and the government traits. So we'll just give our species a randomly generated name, click next, pick from one of the lists of names. And this is going to be one of the easier things to mod in, I suspect, is adding new kind of name lists. I mean, it just calls them name lists. So you've got a bunch of presets, so we'll pick one of the human ones. But you will be able to, I'm sure, fairly easily, just with a text editor, add or modify these lists. Probably adding in your own ones would be better than modifying the ones in the base game files, I suspect. It's actually fairly easy to create simple mods for Paradox games. So you get onto the first important one of these options, which is traits. Now, these are your species traits. And these are your starting species traits, because one thing you have to be aware of is these can change over time. Now, they have this thing called ethics divergence, and that is more to do with this option here. That's more to do with your species, like your societal traits. We'll call them that. Your racial traits can be altered, but as far as I know, the main way of that happening is through a technology that you can get a little bit later on the game, which enables you to add or remove traits, because you might want to remove some negative traits, for instance. So you can actually do it in game. I've also seen what seem like species evolutions or divergences pop up in at least one of my playthroughs, because I've got about four going at the moment. And it's quite interesting because it's the same species portrait, but they actually can end up with rather different looking traits. This is one of those mechanics I don't understand yet. I don't know how that happens exactly. I suspect it is from basically if you have migration treaties with another empire, so that their population units can potentially move into your planets. I think if there's a long enough time passes, that they can start to diverge as a species. And that's actually happened in one of the games I've got. There's at least two species that seem to have diverged, and they're slightly renamed. So that is definitely a mechanic, but I don't understand the exact nature of that mechanic yet. So that kind of natural divergence can happen in the game itself, but it's much more likely you will do it yourself. So, I mean, the tooltips are, not even the tooltips, but the information it gives you in this panel here, it's pretty self-explanatory. And what they've done, I mean, those that have played CK2 will be familiar with the idea of traits and taking a lot of negative traits to enable you to have some very expensive good traits. That same kind of principle applies here, but they have capped it at a total of 4. So you can only start with a maximum of 4 species traits. You also only get 2 points to play with. So what you can do is you can pick only positive traits. So I could pick, say, natural engineers and let's see, something else that only costs 1. Strong, for instance. So this would give me a research boost to one of the research areas. And also it would mean that my armies are stronger, my ground forces. So that, you know, it could be useful. It also kind of limits what you can pick, because maybe you want to pick one of the more expensive traits, but then you can only get one of them. And some of the traits, let's say this one, extremely adaptive, which gives you plus 20% to habitability. So that's the range of worlds that your species can inhabit. Or, well, within a limit, there is a kind of a natural limit to that. Not all species can adapt to all worlds. A lot of it is to do with your homeworld type, but I'll get to that. You have to take negative traits. So if I pick that, I've got 3 picks left, but I've also got minus 3 points there, so I need to take some negative traits to balance that out. And not all of the negative traits are, they're not super negative. It's not like you're going to cripple yourself, but they will have an effect on gameplay. So for instance, slow breeders here means that your populations grow slower, and that's going to have an effect on colonization, how quickly you can fill up a world. Slow learners, that's another, I mean, that's probably a more negative one, because that slows down your leader experience, how much XP that they will get and how quickly they will level up. And weak is the opposite of strong. I mean, a lot of these traits have, again, like CK2, they have a negative. So there's kind of like two sides of the coin, as it were. So I'm just completely doing this as an example. I'll pick, let's just pick intelligent for 2 points, and then we'll pick slow breeders, and we'll pick sedentary, which actually drastically increases, well, resettlement costs. That depends on your civilization's laws, but migration time does affect how much your populations can move between planets. But you can actually have laws that prevent your populations moving between planets, so potentially you could take this as a minus one and actually not really feel the effects of it at all. So we've got now 2 points to play with, and let's see, we can see the grayed out ones. These are the ones that conflict with the ones that I've actually taken already. So we'll take communal for plus 5% population happiness, and we've got 1 point left, so we will take we don't have 1 point left. We've got a trait point, but we actually don't have any picks left, so that's fine. We've got four. That's me not paying attention there. So intelligent and communal, I mean, they're both quite nice. These basically are going to have a really major effect on what kind of species that you have and what kind of laws you have available and how other species in the universe actually view you. But maybe not as much as the actual societal effects. Some of these have an effect on other species, but the societal traits have much more of an effect. So bear that in mind. So we're just going to skip through, and this is just random pick a starting ruler. And okay, now we come on to homeworld. Now this is, again, this is actually an important pick. When you start off, you're going to have a system that's surrounded by a couple of other systems where you will find planets of your preferred type. Now, it doesn't just mean that you can only colonize these particular types, say ocean world, continental world, tropical, arid, whatever. If you, again, use the tooltip, we'll just randomize this, by the way, it will actually, over here, okay, there we go, the continental preference. And by the way, this is also counted as a species trait. This will appear on the species trait list. So we can see continental habitability plus 80%. So that's the prime kind of real estate that our species likes in the universe. But then we look down the list and see tropical, ocean are both at 60%. So our species can live on those worlds, but they'll be a bit less happy about it. And then desert and Arctic are outliers. They're plus 20%. So you can put your species on those worlds, but they're not going to be very happy about it. Habitability directly affects the happiness of your population, and that in turn affects the production of resources and also how likely they are to revolt. So putting the right species on the right planet is actually really important. It's also impacted by technology. You need to research the technologies to settle certain kinds of worlds. You can't just plonk down colonies anywhere you like. You actually will have to research it. So if I go to another one, say Arctic, and mouse over that, it's actually a different set of preferences. So there's overlap between the worlds, but not every species will be able to settle every world. So in this case, it's Arctic is plus 80, ocean and tundra are plus 60, continental and arid are plus 20. And it actually, if you'll notice, it's the neighbors that are plus 60, and then as you follow round, it's those two are the plus 20. So again, if I click there, and you can see tundra and Arctic, this is tundra, is 80%, and then you've got Arctic and arid, which again are the neighbors, and then oceans 20, and then so it's like it's kind of, once you realize this, you can see what planets that you'll be able to colonize. So I won't, if I pick tundra, be able to take continental or tropical worlds with my species, at least not without modding species traits, because these are moddable species traits. Once you get the technologies to change your species traits, that's the thing you can change. You can change your species preference. And you can actually do it for selected populations, which is really nice. you can say, okay, we're going to colonize this world. I'm actually going to, for that selected population, change their species traits so they like living there more. But those are expensive projects when you get to doing them. That's going to be much further down the line. That's not really anything you have to worry about when you're first starting off. Now, you can also, with this particular screen, pick what kind of starting system you want. You can actually start in our solar system. If you don't have, you know, Earth and Sol selected as the names, those will overwrite those, but you'll still have, you know, Jupiter and Mars and Mercury as planets. You can also pick the Deneb system, which is the other kind of default human species, the preset, and random, well, it's just, you know, puts you, it's just random, and the star systems surrounding you are just also random. So we've got all that selected. This is just what you want your city backgrounds to look like, so that's a very, very unimportant one, really. Then we come on to the next big one, which is government and ethics. Now, ethics, as I've said, this is another set of traits, separate. These have much more of an effect on how other species view you. And again, they've gone for this kind of wheel of options. And so things like the planet preferences, what you actually pick here will have an effect on what you can't pick, basically. You can't be a pacifist and a militarist society at the same time, for instance. Now, there's an inner ring and an outer ring, and you've got 3 points. The outer ring are like the stronger versions of these traits. They cost 2 points. So you can always have at least 2 society traits. So I could pick, say, I could be a fanatic, individualist, xenophobic society. So this would be a society that really values individual freedoms, and they're also really not into other species at all. They do not like them. And actually, you can mouse over and see the exact effect. So in this case, it means plus 20% energy credits, but minus 100% slavery tolerance. So there will be no way for your society to actually have slavery as an option, and it also has ethics divergence even plus 10. Now, that is a mechanic, and I'll explain that briefly, hopefully, where although your species starts with these traits, as you spread wider, this ethics divergence mechanic means that populations on more distant worlds will start to split from the mainstream. So it's something you have to be aware of. You have to be aware of how your population is feeling on different worlds about various subjects, because you might end up with some very different ethics popping up in different places, and that can have an effect on, say, rebellions. So it's a thing to be aware of, and it's also a thing to be aware of when you're colonizing, because you will get the option when you build a colony ship for the first time to pick what population you actually want to send to another planet. So that's not going to be an issue at the start, because you've only got this starting set of ethics. But later on down the line, choosing which planet to build your colony ships on could be quite important, because those planets, indeed even individual populations on those planets, will have different sets of ethics. And if you pick a strongly xenophobic element of your society to go and live on a planet that then also gets migration by an alien species, that's going to have a strong effect on the happiness of that population. So you have to bear these relations in the way that these things interact with each other. And that's a very paradox kind of game mechanic. The idea of all these kind of different modifiers balanced against each other, how different species and different populations within species will feel at any given moment, is very much governed by this. So we're going to pick just 3 basic ones. I'm actually going to not go for the extended version. So I'm going to go with Xenophile, which is, if you're not sure about which ones to go for, I mean, it does give you a good idea of what they all are. But the combination the combination of the different ethics will actually give you, it determines what governments you have available, basically. So if I pick collectivist, which is a kind of communist-ish style of species, and then say spiritualist, well, I'm going to have a species that I could go for a very theocratic society, or I could go for a despotic society. And each of these societies has, or each of these government types has a direct effect as well. So, for instance, going for divine mandates, slavery tolerance plus 50%. And that's just flat slavery tolerance, because slavery is split into slavery of your own population and slavery of alien populations. And you can end up with you can have a species, you can design a species which is really tolerant of alien slavery, but really intolerant of slavery of their own species, for instance. So we've got, yeah, xenophile means we'll get along better with other species. Collectivist means that our tolerance of slavery is 50%, but food consumption is also minus 5%. And happiness from spiritualist, well, that just means your populations are a bit happier, but it also means that you're, you know, going to be considered a religious society. So we're actually going to go with, let's see, theocratic oligarchy. And this is actually not a bad one. It is an elective government, but it's every 40 to 50 years. Ethics divergence minus 10% is going to be useful. And also you get reduced leader recruitment costs. So this is just me picking this as an example. So then we come to the empire name, and I'm just going to randomly generate that. And flag, we're just going to leave that as that is. This is a bit bugged at the moment, by the way, the color palette. It's not supposed to be like that. It actually is. If you select the very last one on each of these different options you get, for some reason, it then kind of shows the color palette correctly. It's a bit limited, but I think that's one of the things that's already been modded in. Anyway. And then we come to the final options and starting weapons. One of the things you have to understand with these is that you can research the other kinds over time. It's just this is what you start with and this is what you're going to get the head start with in terms of technology. Now, the various kinds, there's kind of a rock, paper, scissors philosophy going on in terms of weaponry. So ships have two modes of protection. They've got shields and they've got armor. Projectile weapons and missile weapons go through shields and directly impact on armor, but they have various drawbacks. Missile weapons can be blocked, for instance, or you can later on get a technology to basically put point defense weaponry on your ships. You can also, I think, get a kind of electronic countermeasure as another module that you can put on ships, but I haven't actually got there yet. That's quite an advanced one. Projectile weapons are their main limitation is range, and energy weapons are very good against shields and they actually have pretty good ranges, but they are they're very good against armor. So if you come across an enemy that's using a lot of armor but very little shields. So energy weapons are mainly blocked by shields. But in reality, I mean, even though there is this, and this is a weakness of Paradox games generally, is the fighting mechanics. Basically, if you have enough DACA, if you have enough guns, if you have a big enough fleet, you're probably going to beat the enemy unless they just retreat, because that is the thing that fleets can do. They can just retreat out of combat. So although you could, in theory, go, okay, this guy, this species I'm fighting, they're using missile weapons, therefore I will put on, I'll design a class of ship that has lots of missile countermeasures. I mean, you can do that, but you've then got to go and build those ships or refit your existing ships. And that's kind of difficult in the middle of a war. There's no way of getting that intelligence beforehand. And that's definitely a weakness of Stellaris. And I will definitely go into more detail on this in my review video, but at the moment the only way to find out what weapons an enemy AI is using is to actually go and fight them, at which point it's kind of hard to plan ahead as to what you're going to outfit your own ships with. So practically speaking, just have bigger fleets than the other guy. Don't worry too much about trying to counter specific enemies. So I'm just going to pick projectile weapons, why not? So then we come to the biggie. This is a really big one. What kind of FTL method that you use. Now, warp travel is just you can jump anywhere within your FTL drive radius, but it's relatively slow and you have to go to the edge of a star system to use it. So that's a pretty big limitation, actually. It's an advantage, and it's the recommended one for new players for a reason. It's an advantage in that you can go anywhere within your range, but it really depends on how fast your ships are within a system as to how quickly they can react to jump to another system, and sometimes that can be actually a major disadvantage, especially when fighting. Hyperspace travel is a lot more like what Master of Orion has, where you have these fixed hyperspace lanes between different systems, and you can jump from anywhere within a system. Now, this has its limitations because you've then got to follow this kind of maze-like path. You can't, as your technology increases, you're not going to shorten the travel distances. You can only shorten the travel times. That doesn't make any sense putting it that way. With warp drive, let's put it this way. With warp drive, as your technology increases, your jump range increases. That does not apply to hyperspace travel. It's only the speed at which you travel between systems that increases. So it can be a disadvantage at times when you're in a war, because you will have to go through certain systems to get to other systems. Whereas warp travel allows you to much more easily bypass certain problematic systems. So it has a big effect on gameplay. And then lastly, we have wormhole travel, which it recommends only for advanced players. Wormhole travel is the most difficult because although it is pretty fast and you can actually jump, I think, the biggest distances, it also requires you to build infrastructure. And of course, in a war, you've got to protect that infrastructure. Your ships can only go anywhere if you build wormhole stations. And so not only have you got the expense of building these things, but you've then got the fact that you have to defend them later on. And of course, these can only be built by unarmed constructor vessels. You can't militarize a constructor vessel and send it into enemy territory, build a wormhole, and then go, you know, surprise fleet in your home system. It's not going to work, unfortunately. So that one is definitely an advanced option. So far, I've played with both warp travel and hyperspace travel. They both do give a very different feel of gameplay. But when I say that, there is actually a particularly important caveat, and we'll come to that once we've actually created the species. So I'm just going to pick warp travel for now. And we're just going to go with the default mammalian ship design. Okay, there we go. So we've got our species set up. We've got the Adnoran states, as we are called. Unfortunately, you can't type in your own little bio. That would be cool, but you can't. So we're a kind of rather sort of communal, communist-ish, spiritual, and very kind of... We're like space communist hippies. That's what we are. We're space communist hippies. What a combination. I've also got a reasonably nice selection of traits. So intelligence means that our research is going to go faster, and communal means that our species is going to be happier, but we're also going to colonize slower. And if we have the appropriate laws for migrating populations or forcibly resettling population, which is basically forcing a species to migrate from one place to another, or forcing a population, rather, not a species, then obviously that's going to have a negative. But if we don't have those laws, then this is basically we've given ourselves a free trait out of that. So anyway, we'll save the species, and they will now be on our list, and we'll click done. And it's telling me I have unspent points, but actually that's because let's have a look. I think I did it so that I had I had a point left but no trait pick, so I could actually drop one of these for one that costs two, or I could just get rid of one of these negative ones. Actually, let's get rid of, well, no, we'll keep sedentary doesn't hurt you at all. We'll get rid of slow breeders instead. So let's see. Oh no, wait, of course it's oh, never mind. Yeah, no, okay, we might as well just keep those three and not have the extra negative one, because it wouldn't make any sense. Although you could come to think of it, this is just me thinking out loud, because once you get the appropriate technology, this is a thing I don't know, actually. Once you get the technology to modify your own species, as I was talking about earlier, you maybe would have an extra point to play around with. I don't know. I genuinely don't know the answer to that one, but we'll just go with that. Anyway, okay, we'll save that anyway. Okay, right, done. Okay, we're going to create the new galaxy. Now, there's not actually that much options, or that many options at first glance, but the ones that are there are quite important. So, first off is size. You can have up to 1,000 stars, and Paradox themselves have put out screenshots of them testing it with up to 5,000 stars, so you can probably expect mods for bigger galaxies to come along very quickly. We're just going to go with a medium galaxy. Tiny, by the way, is really quite small. That's like if you wanted to have like a challenge game with just two or three civs or whatever, then Tiny would be the one you'd use. Galaxy shape has a big effect, and it also has a kind of a knock-on effect based on this option here, but we're going to go with elliptical. You can get a spiral 2-arm or a spiral 4-arm, and I think in the game I showed off on the stream, I picked spiral 4-arm, but oh no, actually I picked ring, didn't I? We'll go with elliptical anyway. We'll stick with the default there. You can then pick how many AI empires you want to start with. You could just be like one-on-one. You could have a tiny galaxy and you could be one-on-one, except you wouldn't quite be, because there are special AI empires that will spawn regardless of the galaxy size. If I start with this one selected, actually there will be two. There will be another empire called a fallen empire. Now this is a special kind of civilization. They do not expand, they just sit there. But how they behave really does depend on what kind of fallen empire they are. So they might be one that's very kind of paternalistic and condescending, in which case they're just going to sit there and not do a lot. But if you threaten them, they will come down on you hard, because fallen empires are always vastly superior to you in terms of technology and their fleet strength. But you might come across a rather xenophobic fallen empire. And I've had a game where a xenophobic fallen empire declared war on me because I colonized too close to their borders. Now, their interest was not in conquest. They didn't want to take over my planets. They just wanted to force me to give up my colonies. So even though it says one, there will be at least two. But no, we're gonna go with a medium, and we're going to leave it at, I don't know, I guess the default of 17. You can have up to, on a huge one, up to 40 almost. Well, it will be 40 because it'll be plus you, so your game might run a little slower the more empires you have, but let's go with a dozen. Now, advanced AI starts just means that some of those AI empires will have a bit of a head start on everybody else. There was a mechanic in the U4 called Lucky Nations, and it basically gives those particular nations a boost to various things. It's not quite the same in this game. It's the same principle, but it's just they have a head start in that they will have a couple of systems instead of one system, and they might have slightly more advanced technology to start with. So we'll put that at, oh, I don't know, like two. I mean, I'm not really going to play through a game here. I'm aware I've been talking for half an hour already just going through the setup screen. But it will have an effect, especially if one starts next to you. Difficulty options, well, there's no easy, actually. There's just normal, hard, and insane. I recommend you start with a normal if you're playing this for the first time, which, well, everybody is pretty much. There's only a couple of people that will have had an advanced look at this. Now we come to the big one. Now this does tie into the galaxy size and, well, more the shape actually than anything else. But basically what FTL methods the AI is allowed to use, or what everybody is allowed to use. Now this, I think, overrides your species selection. So any means that species will use all three. So you will meet warp species, you'll meet hyperlane species, and you'll meet wormhole species. Wormhole species are really easy to actually spot because you'll see the symbols on the galaxy map for the wormhole stations. But between the other two, it can actually be harder to tell which is which until you see their ships jumping in and out of a system. Because as I said, warp species have to go to the edge of a system, hyperlane species can jump from anywhere within a system. But the options are also to limit what FTL methods are allowed. So you can force everybody to only use warp, or everybody to only use the hyperdrive, or everybody to only use wormhole. Now, as you can imagine, this has a massive effect on gameplay. If you have a spiral arm galaxy with, say, hyperdrive only, suddenly that's a very different game, and this is an option I've actually tried out, because you get certain systems that become military choke points that just wouldn't with a warp game, for instance. So it this kind of setup would have a very different kind of strategic feel when it comes to warfare than having a ring galaxy that has hyperdrive only. I mean, it's still going to have choke points, but it's not going to have choke points in the same way that it does with the spiral arms. Or, I mean, elliptical is going to be probably more similar to ring, but, well, actually, no, elliptical is it's like a donut shape, isn't it? So, yeah, again, that's going to be different, but a bit less different. So these things do tie into each other. We're actually going to go with warp only. And it's, I don't know, this is almost the vanilla option going for warp only. Everybody's on a level playing field. Having it mixed up is a bit more interesting. I think hyperlane only, if you're more interested in that kind of strategic element, that might be the way to go. But yeah, this is one of the big options. This will have a massive impact on how the game plays out. And I can't really state that enough. It doesn't really tell you. It doesn't really give you that kind of information here on the screen, but it really will. And the last one that's available is Iron Man mode. This is actually a common feature in Paradox games. Basically, if you want Steam achievements, you have to play with Iron Man mode. And what that means is you can't save scum. You can only save and load when you're exiting the game, basically. You can only save when you're exiting the game. So you can't save as you're going along and then, you know, something happens you don't like, so you go back to an autosave, for instance. That doesn't happen with Iron Man. I never play with Iron Man on. I have over 600 hours played in, you know, the Steam version of CK2, and however many hundred more played in modded versions. I have never played with Iron Man mode. I don't have a single CK2 achievement in Steam, and I don't even care, because, you know, it's a Steam achievement. It matters not one bit. So, oh my god, after 37 minutes of talking, I've finally gotten to the part where we're looking at the map. This is going to be maybe a longer video than I anticipated, but I want to be reasonably comprehensive for people that are completely new to this, because there is a lot to take in. So you start off with your home species, and you start off looking at your home star system. Now I can hit M, or even just click down at the bottom here, and this will show me the galaxy. So here we are. This is what did I pick? An elliptical. So it is actually, I thought it was more of a going to be more of a distinct ring shape, but anyway. So yeah, it's this is all the stars we have. If I had picked hyperlane as my technology and allowed it or forced everybody to use hyperlane as technology, you'd basically see all the links between systems on this map. But as it is, of course, everybody's using warp. So what matters is actually your jump range. So if I click in the outliner here, which you can click on or use the O hotkey, I can pick my military fleet. This is the jump range. I've actually got, by the way, the enhanced map mode selected. So by default, it's kind of context sensitive. What ships you have dictate what information you have about a system. Now, we don't have any information at the moment. We haven't gone out and looked at what's there. And this is done through your science vessels. So you basically set them to survey a system. So we're going to do that. This is the very first step that you take in any game, is you survey your home system. So you can right click on any object, hit survey system, or you can actually do it from the galaxy map again, by right-clicking and making sure you have your science ship checked. That actually helps. And again, I can click Survey System, and it will automatically catalog every body. You also start off with a construction ship, which is what you use to build stuff. We don't have anything to build right now, but once we have surveyed the system, there will be mineral and energy deposits that we can actually get. You can also build research stations, which will give you extra science. And you also start off with a very small military fleet of the very most basic military craft, which is the corvette. Now this number here represents the military power of this fleet. 75 is pretty terrible. It's, you know, this is the basic of the basic. It doesn't really get any worse than that. I will come to ships in a moment, you know, military ships, but for now I'm going to talk about research first and then the economy. So once you've set your science ship to survey, you'll want to think about what technologies you want. Now, of course, you start off with three available, but technology in this game doesn't maybe work how you think it's going to work. So I'm going to hit F6, which is the shortcut for this button here. And as you can see, we've got three scientists that we're starting with. Leaders, by the way, you start off given a bunch of leaders. You don't have to recruit them. So you'll start off with a scientist commanding your science ship. You need a scientist in your science ship for it to actually work. Other fleets, well, constructor ships don't get commanders, but military fleets do. However, you don't start with one. Don't bother recruiting an admiral to begin with. You only really need admirals when it comes to fighting stuff. And, well, you also get other kinds of leaders, but we'll come to that. So anyway, research. Your leaders have their own traits. So we can actually mouse over and see that this guy is resilient, so he's going to live 25 years longer. Why does that matter, you might ask? People that live longer will pick up more experience and they will become, well, they'll get better bonuses. So at the moment, these are all one-star leaders. They're all one-star scientists. Every bonus level they pick up gives an extra 2% to research speed. So that's actually displayed there at the moment. There are other modifiers that can affect that, but at the moment it is purely just the scientist's skill. They can also give bonuses to specific areas of research. Now, none of these guys do. They've all got their own traits. This guy's got the lifespan thing. This guy, oh, actually, no. Okay, this scientist, Ursula Stein, actually will research things with this symbol here, military theory. So any technology that has this symbol, she will give a 10% bonus to that specific technology. Sometimes it's useful to shuffle your scientists between the different areas, physics, society, and engineering, because they might have a trait, for instance, here, for a technology that's being researched down here. So it's really easy to do. You can just select there and go, okay, I want her to research that area instead, and then we just reassign that guy. Really easy to swap them around. So it's worth keeping an eye on that, because sometimes technologies will pop up that you can get a bonus to that you can actually research quicker. So we'll select our fields of research. Now, how this works is it's like a blind tech tree, and it's almost as though these technologies are a deck of cards. And every time you research a technology and get more available to research, more options, it's like you get the deck of cards is shuffled and you get given a certain number of picks. It randomizes. So there is a tech tree back there somewhere. But exactly what technologies you are given as options at any given time varies dramatically. It's completely random at the start of every game. So this is, I've never started a game. This is my fifth game, fifth playthrough I've started. Not that I probably will play through this, but this is the first time I've had shields as the very first one. And you can end up with games, and this has happened in another game because it's random, where the technology that allows your ships to move around faster inside systems, I still have the basic technology after something like 150, 200 years, something like that, because the improved technology dropped for me once, but there was something else that was better, so I picked that. And then it's just never come up again, which is really unlucky for me, but that kind of thing can happen. So this kind of random drop does have an effect on gameplay. It's not quite the blind research of Sid Meier's Alpha Centauri, which I really like that research system, where you pick a research area and then you get a technology, and you don't exactly know what technology you're going to get. Now, that wouldn't maybe work quite here, because you've actually got research split up into, well, technology split up into three different areas. But still, it's closer to that than it is the traditional tech tree model. So we're going to go with deflectors, which are your basic shield systems for your ships. They're very useful. Society research. This actually seems to be the one that is always available, and it's probably the one that you should always take first, because it gives you colony ships. So actually, having said it's completely random every time, actually not quite. You will always get the option to pick colony ships to research, it seems like. And lastly, we will pick, armor, which is I've already talked about shields and armor being a thing on ships, so we're going to pick the basic level of that. So they're going to sit there and research that. What actually governs this speed are your resources. Now, I'll very quickly run over this now. It seems like a nice lead-in from one to the other. Good lord, it's almost 45 minutes in already, and I'm only just getting to resources. Well, you know, I like to be comprehensive. So we've got our different resource, the three resource pools, and then the three resource gains, if you like. So energy is basically your money. And it's important to know that it is capped. It's actually quite a low cap to start with. All three of these are capped. That's the main difference between these. These are capped, these aren't. Well, kind of. Actually, no, I don't think they are. Because you can build up stores of technology points, but I don't actually think there's a cap to it. I think you could just keep storing them forever if you had a situation where you weren't actively researching. So, energy credits, we'll actually unpause this. Energy credits are your money income. It is produced not only by your planets, but by mining stations that you can build. And also there's a couple of other things. You can build modules on your spaceports, for instance, that give you extra energy credits. So this is an important one to keep an eye on, because you can go into a negative income. You can't, however, go into a negative balance, and that is actually very unparadox-like. What happens is, if you have a negative income, the balance will just go down to zero, and it will sit at zero until you go back to positive. Now, this does have some negative effects on your empire, but it does also mean that it's impossible to go into debt. Debt does not exist in this game. What happens is you get some negative effects to research, to, I think, society happiness, possibly to things like edicts. It might have an effect. Again, this is a mechanic I don't know the full extent of yet, but it also means that you're never going to have to go and, you know, borrow energy credits from somebody else, for instance. You could ask a neighbor, a friendly neighbor, for some energy credits in return for something else. Because obviously having no energy credits, apart from the negative effects, means that you can't afford to, like, build certain things. But in terms of building things, leads me neatly on, the main thing that has an effect there is minerals. Minerals is the kind of catch-all term for what you need to build infrastructure, to build ships. So any kind of anything that needs to be built requires minerals. There are a couple of things that also require energy credits, but mostly it's just minerals. And again, actually, you pay for stuff with energy. Maintaining your fleets costs energy, but maintaining your fleets also costs minerals. So you can have a really big military fleet, and, you know, you might have it balanced in terms of you're just affording it in terms of energy, but maybe it's costing you in terms of minerals. And it makes sense, because obviously fleets, you have to keep them fueled, you have to give them ammunition and all that kind of thing. So there's a mineral cost as well, particularly that is particular to your fleets. I don't think there's anything else that gives you a negative mineral cost. There are certain things that you can do which affect your overall mineral output, but I don't think there's anything else that has a direct cost like that. The third pool is influence. Influence is probably the one you'll use least, but it lets you do various things. So actually, the good old Comet event, if you've played any Paradox game, you'll know that it's a bit of an in-joke at this point, but this actually gives me 40 influence. Now, influence, you're probably most often going to be using for, let's see if I click on the Empire tab, hiring new leaders. So at the moment, at the moment you can see we have 5 out of 10 possible leaders. This is our cap. This will increase with technology. Unfortunately, it doesn't just increase with the size of your empire. You actually have to actively research technologies. So let's say we want to recruit an admiral for our fleet. Now, the traits are coming in handy here. Normally the default is 50, but because I've got the government trait that gives me minus 15%, it's actually cheaper. So we can go recruit. That's cost me that. So let's go ahead and assign this general. So there we go. I've got evasion plus 15%, so they'll take less hits. Okay, so that's one thing you can do with influence. What are the other things? Well, if we click on government, we can see empire-wide, let's see, is policies. Yes. So policies are the laws. They don't actually cost you anything to change, although they can have effects on your population. We'll come to that. But you also get edicts on this screen. So you can spend part of your income. So at the moment, we've got plus 3 influence a month. I can spend 1 influence a month actually going for one of these edicts. So I can do things like increase research speed, but that will also give me plus 15% ethics divergence. Or I can go the other way, which gives negative ethics divergence, or convergence, I suppose you'd call it, at the cost of research. You can also boost specific research areas at the cost of others. This list will increase as your technologies progress. You will unlock new edicts. And sometimes, actually, special research projects will give you new edicts as well. But I'll get to those. So, okay, that's one thing you can do. Well, actually, we've got some events coming up because we've encountered our first something. There we go. Yes, we've got some wildlife, as it were, on the edge of our system. We can zoom in and see. These are... I think these are the space cows, so they're benign. Like the Civ games, there are various kinds of like space wildlife that some of them, most of them, in fact, are inherently hostile, but not all of them. This one kind isn't. But yeah, before we get to that, I was still talking about influence. So the other thing that you can spend influence on is edicts for specific planets, and you actually will do this through the planets list themselves. So the first tab here is where you'll find that. You can change the governor for specific planets here. Obviously, we don't have any other governors, but edicts list. So we can spend a fixed cost. So whereas empire-wide edicts cost a certain amount of influence income, these just cost a certain amount and last a certain period of time. So I can have minus 10% ethics divergence on this particular planet for a period of 10 years for a cost of 150. That's quite useful. There might be particular planets where you want to do certain specific things or give certain specific boosts, bonuses, whatever. Again, that list will increase as you research new technologies. So that's those three pools there. Then you get onto your research income, essentially. You can actually store this. If you're not actively researching something, it will just sit there and accumulate. And what happens with accumulated research is it is used towards projects that you actually are currently researching. One of the ways which you can cheat, by the way, I've discovered a few of the console commands already, but you can basically hit the appropriate key, which is usually on most keyboards, I think for most versions of the game, it's the one that's directly under your escape key. And I can type in physics, and by default it's 5,000 of each. So if I type in physics, it'll go, I did 5,000 tech points. If I mouse over there, it'll say stored 5,000. Now, this is just to demonstrate the mechanic, but if I then go to my research screen and unpause the game, I can mouse over and there we go. So you can see it says base 5 plus the 2% from a scientist, but it's effectively doubled the research speed because it's also now using 5 research from our stored research points. And it does seem to always be just about double. It kind of matches well, actually, no, it doesn't even seem to do that. I'm not quite sure of the exact mechanic, how much it uses. A lot does seem to depend on the technology level. These are all really basic technologies, so it is at the basic, you know, most basic level. It's doubling our research speed, basically. But as a mechanic, I mean, it's there. I'm just pointing out that it's there. Most of the time, it's not going to apply because you pretty much always want to be researching something. It's just, if you aren't researching something, it's good to be aware that that research income, those points, aren't being wasted. The game is actually, pardon me, it's actually storing those. And they will count towards whatever you then decide to research. So that's something to be aware of. So that's research. You can actually boost these with research stations. You can also boost these with things that you can build on the surface. However, this actually takes me onto a different kind of research thing. And again, a mechanic I'm going to point out. So we've encountered our first spacefaring life, and I'll just click those away. Now, what happens is your event log will flash up with an orange overlay, and it'll go, huh, these new aliens have appeared. So, okay, we click research button. This is going to consume society research. Once I've clicked that, I'm going to click back to here, and suddenly we're not actually researching colony ships anymore. What happens is your research output gets diverted to this special research project. There's various kinds of research projects. Your science ship is actually required in order for some of them to be done. Others you can just do from the situation log. So as you can see, it's actually counting down there. And oh, there we go, a leader has gained a level. So she's actually now a more competent leader. And the game always gives you a leader that starts with some kind of research ship bonus, because there's effectively two lots of scientist traits. There's ones that pertain to sending out your ships to actually like discover stuff and research anomalies and do special projects, and the other that is to do with the kind of, you know, main body of research that your society is producing. So we've actually discovered that our star and this gas giant over here can produce extra energy for us, and we don't have a lot of energy, so I'm going to right click. There's a lot of context menus in this, so I'm going to right click on the star, and we're going to say at the cost of 90 minerals plus 2, and you can actually shift click to queue up orders. So I can go shift click, I can right click there, build mining station. So that's really useful. You can do it with all fleets. You can go, I want you to move here, 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 and then I want you to go back into orbit around the planet. Military fleets, by the way, you don't specifically have to tell them to go into orbit, but other kinds of fleets, let's say this ship here, I have to click enter orbit. Otherwise, they'll just kind of sit in space. They won't actually be orbiting around the planet, which means they're not affected, or affected even, by what the various spaceport things can do. Anyway, okay, we found an anomaly. And this is a thing that's popped up on one of the worlds in our system. As you can see, it's this symbol down here. It's a level 2. They have various levels that pertains to the failure risk. Failure risk can mean that the project just fails, that it ends up being a waste of time, that nothing happens. Or it means possibly that you might lose the entire ship. It can happen. Note that these projects, I don't even know whether to call them projects, but investigating an anomaly does not consume any of your research. It might lead to something that does, but for the moment, this is just, they've found a thing, they're going to investigate it. So we're going to say, okay, research. You've also got the option to swap out scientists directly from here, or you can just leave it alone if it's too risky. So we're going to go for that, and we'll actually add it to the list of what it's going to do. The science ship will actually finish what it's doing right now, then it kind of queues that up next on the list, and then it'll go back to what it was doing previously, which is a nice bit of behavior from the game. So this has actually thrown up, let's see, I don't know if that's actually the research. I think this is just a basic event chain that comes along. There are various event chains that can happen. This one gets, I think, triggered for everybody, every new game. So you can basically ignore it, or you can say, I like the idea. And it will give you a task. And this task is to survey 8 habitable worlds. Now, these generally have a reward. Some of them can be really worth doing. But the ones that require jumping around a lot of specific systems, sometimes they're quite difficult to do because, as we can see, I mean, this is the limit of our influence on the galaxy map. We might have one that's like way over here. By the time we have the wherewithal to get over there, that could quite probably be in somebody else's territory, at which point you then have to start negotiating for access for your civilian ships to go in their territory just so you can complete the project. So you don't have to take these, but they can be useful in terms of bonuses that you give. So I think that's one that just fires off automatically. So we're going to start researching this anomaly. We'll actually speed it up slightly and we'll watch this. And once this is done, I'll get onto military ships and the ship designer and maybe go through some of the other panels. And at that point, I think we'll wrap up the video because I've been talking for a really long time at this point. I have to say, I mean, a lot of these things you could probably figure out yourself. The in-game tutorial is not bad, but it maybe doesn't give you that much direction in what you're going to do. And of course, everyone's starting experience is going to be different. I've already said the setup options matter a lot, but it's still, there's certain things that every new game is going to, certain phases every new game is going to go through. So this is the new species we've discovered, the diviners, and the kind of, you know, text you get in these pop-up boxes is actually influenced by the kind of societies that you've picked out. So having a really xenophobic society will have an impact on the kind of text that you get. So again, that's a nice little context sensitive touch. So yes, okay, so and also sometimes the responses you get are governed by your ethics. And sometimes you're actually, well, actually not even sometimes, your responses that you can give to other species when you meet them for the first time are governed by your species ethics. So this is a pop-up to say it's finished. Oh dear. Okay, the constructor fleet has finished the queued orders I've given it, but that's fine. But unfortunately, we experienced a critical failure. So, the 30% failure risk, which was, I think, acceptable. What happened was it has failed so badly that we've lost the ship. And because we lost the ship, we lost the scientist as well. Now I have to build another science ship. So actually, let's do that first. Let's look at spaceports, building ships, and then I'll get onto designing ships. So this is your spaceport. You can directly click on it by clicking the spaceport, or you can also do it by, I mean, it's just a tab of the planet, basically, the planet's summary. It's just a kind of shortcut to go to there. So the spaceport itself, as you can see, you can click on that and you can see various stats for the spaceport, how many hit points it has, any shielding it might have, armor, any kind of modifiers there might be. There are also upgrade slots. At the moment, there's nothing. This is something you will unlock through various technologies. You actually get more kinds of upgrade for your stations than you have slots. You always start off with a defensive, like, weapon slot filled up, basically. But later on, what you will want to do is specialize certain spaceports for certain kinds of slots. So you might have one that's dedicated to building, you know, destroyers and corvettes. You might have one that has various kinds of special things attached to it, where ships that you build will have various kinds of bonuses. So there's things like that to consider. But for now, we're just going to go build, and I'm going to click on a, where are we? Science ship. And you can see the costs here, and you can also see the build time. So that's going to take 2 months to actually build that. So that's fine, that's going to build. We've also got to recruit another scientist, which, where are we? Empire screen. So we'll do that. If I can click in the right place, that would help. At the moment, it's only 3, but again, as technologies go up, the amount of available, like the leader pool, as it's called, will actually expand. So we're going to go with leader experience gain plus 15%, so that they'll rank up faster, basically. So we can't actually assign them to anything right now.
Construction complete.
And there we go. They've actually just finished that, so let's assign our scientist, and we can continue to have them. Let's see, there's probably a couple of one thing that sometimes bugs me is if you might click on a thing and that deselects what you had actually selected. So I've been slightly struggling with the UI at times. It's one of these things where I guess it's just getting used to it. But yeah. So again, by the way, you can shift select. So we've selected to survey that system. We can then shift select and say survey that system. And then I want you to survey that system. And then I want you to survey that system. Now, one thing that does affect those kind of queued orders is your fleet stance. And there are 3 kinds of fleet stance. I mean, there's various buttons here for, you can get them to do various things, but you can also do that through the right click menu. But fleet stance, basically, there's 3 kinds. Evasive means that the fleet will always run away if there are hostiles. Passive means they won't run away automatically if there are hostiles in the same system, but they will not go to engage unless the hostiles get close enough. Aggressive means, you can't get aggressive with science and construction ships, but with military ships you can. So you can have aggressive, and they will actively go after anything that's hostile in the system. So there are various times at which different ones are useful. There are times, if you're setting up a queue of orders like that, you will want to have your science ship to be on the evasive, because you're not paying attention. They might jump into a system where there are hostile aliens. But sometimes, especially if there are hyperplanes, you might want them to bypass a system where there are hostile aliens, in which case you have to set it to passive, but you also have to micromanage it more. You have to jump it through and then make sure the system you're jumping to also doesn't have hostile aliens, because the moment they go into a system with hostile aliens with evasive, they just jump back to the nearest starport. You can't control, you know, they don't just jump back one system, they go all the way back to the nearest starport, basically. So we've found another anomaly, and this time it's still a 30% risk, but we're going to take the risk and we're going to go for that. So that's it for your 2 types of ships you start off with. Obviously there are colony ships as well, but basically they just go where they're sent. There are also transport fleets for your armies, but you don't have any real control over the transport fleets. You just they kind of automatically come with the armies. You just send them into space. You can't upgrade them or anything like that. So we've unlocked this research. We'll just select another research. Ha! Already the next level of shields is available. Completely random drop, so we'll go with that. We're going to start off this game with actually really strong shields on our ship. But we might actually struggle a bit because we won't actually have the power capability to power those shields. We found... Okay, this is another event chain. You probably will encounter the First League, which is basically like precursor aliens. So that again kicks off an event chain. And this is one where you have to find, you know, just through surveying worlds, you have to find and research the projects to get these artifacts. So we found more aliens, so we'll just initiate that research project. Right, so I'll pause it for now because we're also going to now look at the ship designer. Now, Master of Orion also does this. And it actually, I think this has the nicer interface for designing your ships. Now, for the most part, it auto suggests ships. In fact, even if you don't... And you can check this button, and I think it will actually automatically update your ship designs if you have this checkbox down here. But it will automatically generate any time you research a new class of ship hull. It will auto-generate a design, but it might not necessarily be a very good design. In fact, it'll probably be a very basic design. But we're starting off with very basic technology, so I can't really have better than this right now. I can stick some shields on this, but. Before I talk about sticking shields on things, I'll go through what the various things mean. So the corvette's the basic military ship. You've got your weapon slots up here. You've got your, I don't know what to call these technology slots, your system slots, I guess. So it's your warp drive, your combat computer, which at the moment it doesn't do anything, but later on you can... sort of fine-tune your ship classes so you can have one that's better suited to defense or one that's better suited to attack. I think you also can put an ECM thing in that slot, or maybe that's a further down slot. There is actually a fifth slot that only appears on buildable defense stations. I think also cruiser class and battleship class have a fifth slot where you can put in special things. You've got your conventional engine technology. So this is what the ships use to move around inside of systems. So warp technology is obviously between the systems. So the game I mentioned way earlier, I've got like level 4 warp drive, but I've still only got level 1 chemical thrusters. You know, the basic kind of... You know, my ships are sailing around with super advanced weapons and they're still sailing around on rockets, essentially, which is a bit silly, but like I said, the random technology drop means these things can happen. And then lastly, there's the sensors, which it's kind of influences your sensor range, but also possibly has an effect in combat. I don't actually know. So then in the bottom, you have your slots for, utility. You start off with basically only power, but also I've researched shields, so those are now available. So you've got your list of stats over here. The names are automatically generated. You can change that, or if you do change it, it'll give a new class. So if I say it's the not very good class, it actually generates that. It kind of splits that off from the existing corvette class. So we can actually delete that, you know, and we don't need that anymore because we've made our own. So if you want to like hive off a class of ship, just rename it and it'll save it as a separate class, essentially. If you want to have a just update a ship, you just hit the save button. So there's an autocomplete button here, which you'll notice. You can hit that and it will try and basically balance your utilities and some of your sort of technology slots based around what you select for weapons. Now we've only got the very basic weapons available at the moment, so if I click autocomplete, it should fill up these slots here, and lo and behold, yes, it's gone. Okay, I need an extra reactor if I want to have shields. Now the corvette only has small weapon slots, and you know what we're going to do is I'm going to go to one of my save games and I can actually show this off a lot more, where I've got a lot higher levels of technology. So I'll be back in just a second. So here we are. This is probably my most advanced playthrough at the moment in terms of technology. As you can see, I've got a decent amount of territory under my command. I've got some pretty strong fleets. But I'm also kind of hemmed in at the moment because I, again, a mechanic I don't quite understand, but I won't really go into that because we came here for a specific reason, that is to look at the ship designer. So I'm going to bring it up. And as you'll see, I have a lot more stuff available. So it doesn't quite... It tends to, like, the most recently updated design goes down to the bottom. So these aren't really in a particular order here. If I update this design, it will then go whoop down to the bottom because that's the most recently changed one. So you've got various kinds of defense stations. You start off with the defense platform, which is pretty basic. Defense station, which is bigger. And then the fortress. And one of the government types actually gives you the military station as an option as well. So I think that's even bigger. You've also got the various kinds of military ships. So corvettes you've already seen, destroyers are the next one up. You've got cruisers, which are your reasonably big ships, and then battleships, which are the big ones. You don't get anything bigger than a battleship, but probably bigger classes will be modded in. People will bring in bigger classes. So we'll go with the battleship because it's got the most modules. Now, one thing I didn't mention, which doesn't really pertain to the corvette, you have the different cores. And you get three different corvette cores, but honestly, the kind of default starting one with the three small slots seems to be the best. I think it doesn't really start to matter until you get to destroyers-ish, and then it's much more noticeable once you get to cruisers and battleships. And we're just going to go with the battleships because the battleships have the most of everything. So we're going to actually, I think we'll just create a new design. So we're going to say we want a new battleship, if I can find it on the list. And here we go, completely blank. It does, however, have the technology slots selected, automatically filled. So I've got my best hyperdrive, which is, as you can see, there's a small usage, a small mineral cost that goes with that. But also there's a power cost with your hyperdrive as well. And we'll call this the test class. So you've got the combat computer, and I've actually got some stuff unlocked now. So the basic versions basically give you plus 10% to either your like weapons rate of fire and weapons damage, or you can go for a more defensive ship and bolster their defenses, so more hit points and better evasion chance. And then you get the advanced versions, which are basically more of the same, but, you know, with slightly more cost. And as you can see, actually, these also cost some power. So I'll actually go with offensive. And actually, as you can see, this has an effect on, say, your hull hit points. But it also has an effect on maintenance cost, on your weapons output. Well, it would if I had any weapons selected, but it has a knock-on effect. Then we've got our like sublight drive, we'll call it that, for ease of knowing what it is. Then we've got sensors, which it's just, again, a linear upgrade. There's not really the choices apart from it's really only the combat computer that gives you those choices. And then we get the special slot, which actually you get a bunch of things that are quite expensive. So you can go with absolutely nothing at all, or you can pick something. You can basically pick things that help your allied ships or help actually do bad things to enemy ships. So the kind of blue ones are, you know, this one helps repair allied ships, or this one helps with allied ship shield regeneration. This one actually harms enemy shield regeneration. This one, let's see, has an effect on enemy rate of fire. So you can have some quite powerful effects, but these are also really expensive to mount. So let's say I have that one. That has a massive power cost. That costs 200 power to maintain just that module alone. So this is going to affect how much your primary firepower is going to be affected. So you, once you get those particular slots available, you're going to want to maybe have a couple of specialized classes. But I think for your corvettes, your destroyers, maybe even the cruisers, don't worry about it too much. You can just have one class and it's fine. Battleships, however, you might want to have a couple of different classes. So we're just going to leave that blank. And I'm going to click autocomplete. It will suggest a design based on the technologies I have. But what if I don't want this? Well, this tells me 95 attack damage is pretty good. And you can also see there the mineral cost. Now, this has optimized it so it is completely sort of balances out in terms of power. There's no power left over on the ship. If I stuck in another power generator into this slot, for instance, suddenly there's spare power. But, you know, that power isn't doing anything. It doesn't help the ship to have spare power. So there's no point to that. You want to have your ships be as balanced as possible in terms of power requirements. But what we're going to do is, I don't want this design, I want a different design. So with battleships, you can pick from three different kinds of hull sections. This is unaffected by technology. Once you unlock battleships, you've got this, basically. It's going to look different based on what your actual your ship design is like that you picked at the species, you know, creation stage. But the slot, the slots that come with them are basically the same. So let's say I want to make a class of carrier. So I'm going to pick this. Now, you might be wondering, what are all these? Well, the different various kind of slots come in different sizes. So you've got small, medium, and large. A reactor in a large slot is going to produce more power than a reactor in a small slot, for instance. Same goes with weapons. A large weapon's going to do more damage and have more range than a small weapon. Although, I have noticed small weapons generally have higher accuracy, at least for laser weapons. I'm not sure if that's true across the board. But sometimes having small weapons is, you know, it's not necessarily a bad thing. Bigger is not necessarily always better. But we want to go with a hangar, which is this yellow one here. So this is a special slot. And we actually, okay, we can, in the midship section, we can add more hangars. And then in the aft section, well, let's say I want, I don't know, four small weapon slots. And you might be thinking, oh, bigger's better. Not necessarily. Sometimes you can actually have more attack power by having four small weapon slots than you might do with one big weapon slot. But some weapons are limited. Some weapons you can only put in small slots. Some weapons you can only put in large slots. So if you have a particular weapon in mind you want to put on your ship, I don't have any large weapon slots on this ship at all. I can't mount... there's a particular kind of weapon. Where is it? Let's see. Kinetic batteries. So these are basically big rail guns. I can't mount these on this ship, but I can mount these, which are point defense guns. They're not offensive guns, but they can only go in the small weapon slots. So having picked out the different ship sections I want, I'm going to click autocomplete. It's going to suggest a design. And as we can see, my attack power is now much higher. And a big part of that is the fact that I've used hangars with these amoeba strike craft, which you get through basically a research project. You will start off with just a scout wing. They're not very powerful, but they also don't cost a lot of cash. So, well, they don't cost a lot of resources on the ship, as it were. So if I click that, for instance, it would make a difference. Suddenly there's more power. The cost has gone down, but my attack power has also gone down quite dramatically. It's quite easy to, well, you'll figure it out. It's you just click on things, basically. You can also right-click to clear a slot entirely and just leave it empty. You can leave weapon slots empty. It's not like you have to fill every slot. If you're struggling to balance your power requirements, maybe you want to leave a large weapon slot empty, for instance, but you probably wouldn't. So what I can do, and what the game will do, if... I didn't mean to type in there. Oh, for goodness sake. Right, we're going to save the ship design. Right, okay, before we modify it any further. So this is now saved as a battleship design. What you can do is you can say, right, I've got a mix of weapons here. It suggested a mix of weapons. What if I only want to have... I don't have very advanced missiles, so let's not go for missiles. But let's say I want to have... gamma lasers. Let's just all gamma lasers. So we're just going to go with everything's gamma lasers. And suddenly, as you can see, we've got -5 power. We can't actually launch this ship class. So if I click on autocomplete ship, once you customize what weapons you want, it basically will automatically try and balance your power requirements. Now, there's one way in which it won't, and I think this must be a bug. If you've got a special thing in the technology slot, and I go like that, like okay, 175 minus 175, I want to balance that. It just removes it. So that's a bug. If you've got any kind of special thing selected, you then have to manually balance the power, you know, reactor versus shields, whatever, yourself. That must be a bug. I mean, I can't imagine it's not. Not that we want a special thing on our ship, but anyway. So we'll click that again, and it's 10 power left over. That's fine. Now, I wonder if we can maybe... and you can mouse over and see like the various stats for each kind of class of weapon. Actually, it's true for railguns as well, so small weapons are more accurate. So maybe I want some point defense batteries on this ship, which will protect against people with missiles. My attack power is going down, but effectively I've, you know, made the ship better defended. Now, in terms of shields versus... well, I've kind of split that word up weirdly there, I don't know why. In terms of shields versus armor, I think shields are probably preferable a lot of the time, but you're going to meet, obviously, enemies that are using things that ignore shields. So also having some armor on your ship is worthwhile. So at the moment, 2,000 shields is pretty well defended. I've also got a decent amount of armor. You could just entirely discard shields, which is not a good idea because you're going to meet species that use lasers that will go through armor like butter. I mean, you need both, basically. You might favor one over the other. But basically, I've got suddenly a massively armored ship. And as you can see, damage reduction 59%, but lasers are going to ignore that damage reduction effect. So you need to have both, ideally. There's also, I mean, it's not just power and shields. There are some special things you can put in these slots as well. So regenerative hull tissue, if we replace that in, say, that slot, mouse over that, monthly hull regeneration 2%. So you can have ships that repair themselves without having to come back to a space dock to repair. They will slowly repair over time. Or you could have a shield pasta, which actually has the same energy cost as a shield going in the same slot, basically. So you might replace a shield with a shield capacitor, say that one there. That should have the same effect. Actually, no, that costs less energy wise. So basically this boosts your shield regeneration rate. So that's ships, basically. You can customize and tinker and specialize if you want, but realistically I don't think you're going to need more than say two or three classes of cruiser and two or three classes of battleship. I've only in this playthrough got myself two different classes of battleship. I've got one that has one of these special things and has a pretty respectable attack power, but I've got one that I basically haven't got a special tech thing in the slot and actually has even better attack power for a cheaper cost. So, you know, these are kind of like the mainstays of the fleet, and then I've got a couple of the other kind to use their special abilities. That's pretty much how you want to do it. So I mean, we'll go back to the other game and I will actually I don't even have to, because I was gonna say I'll cover the basics of colonization, but I can maybe do that in this game, or I might not have any planets left to colonize within my own space. Yeah, I'm going to have to go back to the other game. So, again, we'll do a little, you know, star wipe or whatever it was I was doing, and I'll cover the basics of colonization and planets, and then I think I'll wrap things up there, because this video is getting ridiculously long at this point. So, we're back in this save. I've put things up to maximum, and I am basically just waiting for... I'll actually cancel that project. Because what I'm going to do is technology screen. I'm going to wait for the colony ship to finish. Then I'm going to build a colony ship. And in the meantime, hopefully we will have found even a habitable planet. And there's going to be one, at least one, probably two or three around near me that my species likes. Because that's how the game generates these starting areas. It gives you a couple of planets around you that you can colonize. There will always be at least two or three. Outside of that, you might then have to go quite a long way to find more. So sometimes having different kinds of species inside your empire that can colonize different worlds, or maybe modifying certain populations, you know, on certain worlds, that they can then inhabit different kinds of planets. Anomaly. That can be an option as well. We found another anomaly, but we're just going to actually skip that because we want to find planets. We don't care about anomalies that much. So, yeah, I will skip ahead here because this might take a little bit to get the colony ship finished. Okay, so we haven't actually got the colony ship yet, but a thing has popped up, which is quite interesting, and it allows me to talk about another mechanic. The spacefaring civilizations that you meet are not necessarily the only kinds of life you will find in the galaxy. Now, I've already talked about the spaceborne life, but in the course of surveying this nearby planet, we've found a pre-spaceflight civilization. Now, these can vary. You can get them all the way from sort of like literally Stone Age technology all the way up to early spaceflight. And the early spaceflight ones, actually, if you leave them alone, they will develop into spacefaring civilizations in their own right. Obviously, one of these civilizations that's Stone Age, it's probably not going to happen in the lifespan of your game. It might do, but, you know, given that it would take thousands of years of history and technology, it's probably unlikely to happen on its own. So you've got a couple of options when this happens. You can use your construction ship to build... if it's inside your territory, I should say. This is outside my territory at the moment. But if it's inside your territory, you can build a construction ship, or send a construction ship to build an observation post. An observation post on its own will give you a bit of science, but you can also tell that observation post to actively begin bringing that pre-spaceflight civilization up to your level, at which point they automatically become your vassal. However, that doesn't mean that they'll necessarily like you. It's possible to find one of these pre-spaceflight civs that's xenophobic, in which case they're not going to be the best vassals ever. You might have to work on making them like you a bit. And obviously your own traits matter as well. If you've picked repugnant, for instance, and you just have wildly clashing societal ideologies, then that's again going to count against you because there are all these modifiers going on. So, well, these guys are in the medieval age, and the age that they are at basically dictates... actually, they've just progressed to... maybe it means Renaissance when it says medieval, but they've progressed to that kind of level. I can actually click and see... Yeah, there are these guys on the planet screen. They are xenophobes, as I was saying, fanatic materialists. So we'd have to work on them a bit. Now, there's actually another kind of planet-based species you can find, pre-sentient life. Once you have a certain level of technology, and I think I just lost my military fleet. Oh dear, whoops. I was sending them out scouting around. They can't actually survey systems, but you can send them into different systems, and you can at least sort of get rid of the fog of war to some extent. But yeah, pre-sentient life, you need a special research project to uplift them to sentience. And that can maybe slightly backfire on you as well. Again, they're not necessarily going to react well to suddenly having been brought to intelligence. But those projects take a very long time to complete, and they're also quite resource intensive. However, it can be useful to have vassal civilizations. You can even peacefully integrate those civilizations once you've uplifted them. The other option is, based on what kind of laws you have, let's see, go to policies, and if we go to, okay, native enlightenment is whether or not we can bring up natives to our, like, we, you know, like pre-spaceflight civs using an observation post to, you know, that spacefaring level. So I've clicked that, okay, that's allowed. We can't change that policy for another 10 years. Native interference, well, if you click unrestricted, if you have that option, because you, for me, it's greyed out because I'm a xenophile. What ethics your society has an effect on what laws you can, you know, pick, essentially. If I had unrestricted, another way that you can deal with these pre-spaceflight civilizations is just to land some armies on their planet and go, right, you're with us now, whether you like it or not. Now, obviously, they're maybe not going to be very happy about that. They may in fact just rebel, but generally speaking, of course, as long as you have some armies present, they really can't do a lot because they've gone from sort of medieval technology to you showing up. And they probably still have like swords and whatever the horse equivalent is on their planet, and you've got lasers and spaceships. So that's one way of adding different species to your empire. You can do it by force. Or you can peacefully integrate them, which does take longer, but generally makes them a bit less unhappy. So there you go. That's a thing that's popped up. I'm still looking for a planet where I can colonize. I'll actually build a second science ship. How about that? So I'll click on there in the outliner and we'll build another science ship. Well, one thing I can talk about is the actual planet screen itself. Now, you've got the planet summary, which gives you an overview of the resource output. So at the moment, we're doing all right. Plus 10 energy, plus 13 minerals. That all contributes to our sort of total output, obviously. Habitability, as I mentioned way back towards the start of the video, this has a big effect on primarily your population happiness, but also I think it has an effect on the growth rate of populations on your planet as well. So we can see what effects the governor has here, and I think this is just the total kind of base output of your planet, because if we click on the surface tab, we have this. Now, this is a growing population, this kind of faded population here. These are all fully grown populations, and these here in the background of these squares are different buildings. Now, you'll notice here it says 9. This is basically the kind of the total habitable area of a planet. Big planets can basically fill up this entire area. This is all, you know, this can all be squares potentially. You won't find too many planets like that. You can also have planets that only have like 7 or 8 habitable squares, and obviously they're going to be less desirable because they have less resource output. But even if you have a really quite small planet, or even a moon, you can have habitable moons in this game. You can start off on a habitable moon. You can possibly still have one of these planets in a really strategic location, because colonizing a planet extends your borders, essentially. So you're looking at this and you're thinking, what are these yellow stripy things? Well, there's two kinds of stripy things. You get the red stripy things, which are these tile blockers, as they're called, which you can't clear yet. But on your home planet, you always start with yellow stripy ones, which are tile blockers that you can clear. And that is for a cost of minerals and energy. Now, these can be up to 100 each, but on your home planet, it's always relatively cheap. So we can see how long that will take. So we'll clear this one. And we'll let that project go along. Now, this then means that we can get population in that square, which will contribute to the overall planet output. Now, I can look at the moment and see we've got +4 food, which affects our population growth, as we can see here from this tooltip. And as long as you have enough food for your population, it only has to be really like positive by 1. You don't have to have it positive by a lot. And yes, I know the research things up here and it's reminding me that it's available, but it's fine. You know what, at the moment we're accumulating stored research points, so it's fine. I'm talking about the thing. So we've cleared that, and actually once you've cleared a tile, in fact even just with tiles you already have, you can swap populations around. Now you've got some buildings built already. We will build a hydroponic farm, which will boost the food output. If you have a tile that has multiple outputs, which your planetary administration always will by default. That's like your capital, basically. That will always have at least 2. Well, no, I don't think it at least 2. I think it will always have 2. I don't think it can have more than 2 outputs. Oh, actually, no, I tell a lie. As you upgrade that later on, it can output leadership points as well. But yes, if you've got one of these that has 2 different resources on it, well, if I click, let's say I want energy, it will warn me that I will lose the mineral output of that tile. So sometimes you will have to choose what output is most important to you. Now the other thing that's here, we've got that population there, but at the moment that's being not worked. You know, there's no population there, so that is just sitting there costing me money. Each of these buildings costs a maintenance level. So we'll move a unit of population there. Hey presto, that's being worked, suddenly the planet has more food. So population management in that way, quite simple. But later on, once ethics divergence really kicks in, individual populations on a planet, well, they're not necessarily even going to be of the same species, but even if they are of the same species, they will possibly have different kinds of ethics. And maybe even, well, if they're different species, they'll have different traits, but you might have modified your own species and moved various pops around the place. So you might have the same species but with different traits on the same planet. So you can mouse over and see that, at the moment, they're all going to have the same traits. You can see the population happiness, and that's what this bar is here, by the way. So the happier they are, as long as they're over a certain amount of happiness, they will give you the full amount of resources from that tile. If it starts to drop, if it becomes yellow, they will be unhappy, and the resource production will drop. They might even get unhappy enough that they join a faction and want to rebel. So it's always worth having population be happy. And like I said, habitability of the planet has a major effect on that, but there are other things as well. Now, you can have an edict that increases happiness. I don't have it available right now, but you can spend leadership points to make your populations more happy. There's also one special building you can get later on, which relies on special strategic resources which you will find around the place, which have kind of specific effects. One of those later on lets you build a zoo, which has an effect on the happiness of that planet. So if you've got a particular planet where you've got a problem keeping the population happy, you can build a zoo and suddenly they'll be happy. Evading hostile fleet. So this is them automatically jumping. Actually, no, I told a lie earlier. I said that they jump back to the nearest starbase. They don't. They just jump back to the nearest friendly system. Okay, so we'll survey in that direction as well. I've also got a science ship that's sitting doing nothing, so let's get a leader on that. So I'm still trying to find a planet where I can actually recruit. Yes, there we go. I didn't even see what that trait was, but no, that's the leader lifespan one, isn't it? So we'll... you can actually draw select over the galaxy map to select specific ships, but you can also do it from the outliner as well. You can also actually, if I select on the outliner, say that construction ship, and I say control 1, will that do what I wanted to? Maybe I actually have to go and look at it in the actual map view. Control 1. No, that's not doing what I wanted to do. Oh, there we go. Okay, it took... No, actually, that's the mining station. I don't want the mining station. I want the construction ship. There we go. So the construction ship is now, that's on the hotkey, the 1. So you can use the 1 to 10 buttons as hotkey, and it's a little bit like getting it to actually do what I want can be a bit control 2. There we go. So that's gone and done what I wanted to do. And then that one, control 3. There we go. So we'll right click to look at that. What is in range? That system's just in range. We'll send them there. Anyway, what was I talking about? I've actually quite forgotten now, which is a bit bad. I don't know. I think I was just saying that we're still looking for a planet to build a colony ship on. And I can actually... I've got the technology. I should have started this already. Let's build a colony ship. Now, later on, by the way, once it doesn't matter to start with. If everybody on the same planet has the same ethics, then it just builds a colony ship. Later on, it'll give you a little pop-up and say which population exactly do you want to send off to colonize somewhere. So that's a thing to be aware of. Also, I've just completed a bit of one of the event chains, the habitable world one, I think. I've actually done all 8. So let's do the mouse over, because the overlay over... I know what I mean. Because, as it turns out, I was completely wrong. We have actually found some habitable worlds. So it was just I didn't have this selected. This normally, if I have the construction ship and I don't have that selected, it's only when I have the colony ship selected, it's context sensitive, that I will see habitable worlds. But you can basically have all the information at once, so I can see resources and whatever. So I don't know, let's have the construction ship build. There's things I haven't built. You can, in fact, select the construction ship, right click and say I want to build all mining stations in this system. So you can, if you're not bothered about the specifics, you can actually you might not necessarily want to do that. There might be reasons why you don't want to do it, but you can also if you want to. So survey that one. That grayed out there means, by the way, we know there's a habitable planet in that system, but it's not actually been surveyed yet. So green means it's habitable at 80% or above. Yellow means it's habitable at 60%. And red means it's... basically, we don't have the technology to colonize it, or else we don't have the appropriate habitability traits on our species, because there are some worlds, remember, that you just cannot colonize unless you mod your species much later on. So we've got the colony ship built. We will go for this very close planet here. Actually, no, we'll go for this system here. This system has more resources. So there's a couple of ways of colonizing. Again, you can right click on, let's see, it's this planet here. I can tell because it's green. I can right click and say colonize. But generally, I find it easier to click on the planet itself. And oh, this is a really big world. Look at that. Lots of tiles. This is excellent. Generally, one of the starting worlds does tend to be bigger, but that might be just a random thing. That might just be, you know, luck on my part. So we can click on here, and it will tell us the available colony ships. Now, at the moment, it's only one, but let's say you've got colony ships for different species around the place. This list becomes really useful because, obviously, if you send the wrong colony ship to the wrong planet, you're going to have a really unhappy population, because suddenly they're on a world that they don't like to be on. It's also possible with sectors, and I haven't even covered sectors, I don't think I'm going to get to in this video, but sectors are basically administrative, autonomous, semi-autonomous units that you can set up. You can get your sector planets, if they have a starport, to actually also build colony ships. But sector-built colony ships do not show up on your civilian ship list. They do, however, show up on this list. So I find it really useful, and I think everybody should like at least be aware of this, to use the colonize button on an empty planet rather than just going to the ship and then right clicking. I think this is far more useful. So we can say yes, we want that ship, and it then says, okay, where do you want the capital to be? Now, as we saw on the homeworld, the capital always has like two resources. So wherever we place this, we'll kind of get a bonus. I think it gives us food by default from the capital alongside any other resource that might already be in the tile. So let's go for a fairly central one, because there's also a knock-on effect from the capital. And I can actually show you that on the homeworld. So these arrows here, they basically boost everything in these four cardinal point tiles. So putting your, if we go to this world, let's say I put the capital here at the side, or like right in the corner. Occasionally you're forced to because of the tile blockers. You might have a planet that's like really big, but it's got lots of tile blockers, and you're forced to put your capital down in the corner. Sometimes it can't be helped. But if you have the ability to actually put it down where you can get that benefit of having those four cardinal point boosts available, then you should do it. And in this case, we're going to put it there. So one of them is going to be blocked by a tile blocker. I can't actually remove right now, but later on I'll get the technology to remove it. Where, of course, if you put it against the edge here, you can't then, you know, later unlock a tile here. It just doesn't work that way. So the colony ship's going to jump. We can actually follow the colony ship. It's got to go all the way to the edge of the system because, of course, we're using warp technology. It's going pop, 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 and then it's going to jump all the way down here, and we're going to colonize our first planet. And then I think I will wrap up the video because, for goodness sake, I'm getting on for 2 hours recording time here. But, you know, I wanted this to be comprehensive. I do keep saying that, but I want to make that clear. And maybe I'm just being overly explainy about everything, but a lot of people coming to Stellaris might not necessarily have played Paradox games before. They might not really have an idea of what's going on. So it comes with a pop-up, this is our first colony. And because we had it on like fast speed, it's basically just happened very quickly. But if you have it on normal speed, it actually takes a little while for the colony to get set up, just in terms of, you know, landing everything. Then what happens is this process. Now, colonizing is expensive. You could go nuts, build a lot of colony ships, which are quite expensive to maintain themselves, but also research an anomaly, why not? Go nuts. Just the process of colonizing a planet, just setting up this initial foothold, costs you 8 energy a month. So having a nice stockpile of energy if you're going on a colonizing wave is useful. Let's see. Okay, that was our first league thing that just failed, so there was no result from that. I should probably finally get some technology going, shouldn't I? So ion thrusters and a technology that gives extra influence, why not? And solar panel network. I could have gone for the improved sensors there, in fact, anyway. So Even just in the process of colonizing, already the borders have extended. They will extend fully once the colony is established. And as you can see, this kind of progress bar here tells you how far it is along. Now, this does take a little while, but we're on the very fastest speed here, so it's fine for now. I've also got this indicator telling me I've got an unemployed pop. And I think that actually does affect... No, it doesn't affect happiness. It's just they're not doing anything. They're not actually producing anything for your empire. So let's go ahead and tell them to build a mining network. So get extra minerals. And I might actually, even though this is one that does produce minerals already. Well, in fact, no, we'll clear that tile blocker and then build a power station there. But actually, no, I think we also do want to build a power station here as well. And I think I clicked a bit too quickly for the UI there, which is a thing that happens in other Paradox games. Sometimes you click through a panel and it'll go, oh, did you want to click there? No, I didn't actually click there. I clicked in the vicinity, you know, I clicked on the panel, but it acts as if, yeah, anyway, that's just a UI design thing there, and it's not particularly important, and I don't know why I'm going on about it. So building a power plant there, and it's gonna go, you're gonna lose the mineral, but that's fine, because power is a thing that you actually, your energy credit income, it's a thing you're really going to have to watch like a hawk, because it has a massive effect on like your entire empire, basically. I'm being very lax about sending these science ships out to actually, you know. But I'm just explaining stuff. I'm not really properly playing this here. I'm just explaining stuff. So we've set up our planet. We've already got a population growing, and they will automatically have less happiness. So what you can do, at least for your first couple of planets, we've got enough, more than enough influence points stored to have individual governors. So we'll go, okay, we'll have a governor. Governors level up the same as every other kind of leader. So that will improve the population happiness. I guess it overwrites planets, like the planetary capital overwrites science income, so maybe it's better to put it on a square where it's either just mineral or food income or just a blank square. So okay, there's a thing we've learned, there's a thing I've learned. I didn't actually I hadn't noticed that previously. What we can do, though, I mean, we don't have to, we can control up to 5 planets directly, but I'm going to create a sector just so I can explain sectors. Then I promise we're going to wrap the video up, because sectors are a fairly important game mechanic and I think they're worth knowing about. So on the planets tab, okay, we've got a list of planets. We can actually see that we've got a starport here that's got one empty module. It'd be really nice if you could just click on that and actually directly build from your planets list, but you can't, unfortunately. Not now, anyway. I'm sure it'll come later on. It's just one of those little life improvements that will be added, I'm sure, in the many patches to come. So what we're going to do is we're going to create a sector, and at the moment we can have a maximum of 2 sectors. So create new sector, and that takes us to the galaxy map. And of course you can't add your capital to a sector, it's your capital, you have to have one directly controlled world at least. But this new colony, okay, we can say I want this to be a sector. Now adding planets to a sector, I think it's free, but removing planets from a sector costs you 25 influence, so just be aware of that. So okay, we've got our sector, we're no longer getting the direct benefit of anything that planet actually produces. But if we go to planets tab again in our empire screen, well, what we can do is we can say, okay, we want a sector governor. Now this sector is now effectively under AI control, but you can give the AI certain pointers as to what you want it to do. Now there's a couple of buttons here that you don't really get any options here other than to click on the world itself, you know, go to the world directly from the directly controlled planets list. However, with sectors you've got some options. You can actually click there and see what planets are there, but it starts off by default as I can't think of the word, but there's a word for it. It starts not displaying the list of planets. Wow, that was clunky. So there's a couple of options. You can directly dump in energy and credits to the sector to kickstart things, or if it's running at a deficit maybe. So if I hold shift, I can give it 100. By default it's like, actually no, it's 100 by default apparently. I thought it was like less than that. Normally alt click and shift click kind of like gives you differing amounts in Paradox games, but apparently not this time. I've been uselessly holding down shift the entire time. So you can do that, and that will kickstart. The AI will use those credits and whatever that I've given it to build stuff on the planet. We can actually unpause it, and we should see that going down at some point. There we go. It's used it to, like, do something. I don't know. It might be the moment. Oh, there we go. So it's building a hydroponics farm. So yeah, it's doing a thing. So we have some other options here. We have the priorities list. So you can say, I want this sector, and it's the sectors as a whole. This affects what buildings the sector will build. You can say, I want you to have a military focus, and they will build stations, and they will basically build armies and do, you know, various things. They won't build ships on their own, but I think they will build defensive stations, and they'll give modules on those space stations, like military modules, a priority if they're available. You can also have a couple of economic focuses. So you've got industrial, and they'll try and produce more minerals. You've got research, and they will concentrate on building labs, or financial. So you can have a sector, for instance, that's mineral rich that you prioritize to minerals. So it's giving you mineral income or research or, you know, whatever. The final thing is this button here, top list anyway. Basically, you can, unfortunately, you can't right click to go down. You can only kind of click to go up. So you can say, I want the sector to basically keep everything it's producing, and it will all go into developing itself, basically. Or you can say, okay, I want 25% of the energy and minerals up to a total of 75%. So to start with your sectors, you probably want to have them at 25 or 50%, just so that they can develop. But once they get richer, you can easily bump them up to 75%, and they will give you a much bigger contribution. The last two check buttons, or radio buttons, or whatever you want to call them, are allow redevelopment and respect tile resources. So respect tile resources means that it will try and build hydroponic farms in tiles that have food, for instance. I mean, it will, based on your sector preferences, empty tiles, it'll build, you know, minerals, you know, mines, or it'll build power plants or science labs, whatever. But for those tiles that do have a resource already, it will go, okay, you've got society research as a resource, so I'll build a science lab. It won't build a power plant on that particular tile. However, you can turn that off, and suddenly it will, okay, it'll go, okay, I am, I have industrial focus, so I'm just going to build a lot of mines and then have enough food and energy to support that. You can also click allow redevelopment, and so what that does is when different kinds of buildings come along, you can say to the AI, okay, you can actually redevelop a building, because what you can do is you can say, okay, this is a mine at the moment, but I actually want to replace it with a power plant. And it allows the AI to do that. But you can also, you know, effectively disable the AI from doing that. So I've got a bunch more technologies available. I'll just click a bunch of research speed plus 5. That's a useful one to get earlier on. So yeah, that's it. We've started an empire. Now, there's a lot more stuff to do with diplomacy and meeting other species later on, and interspecies relation. But this is basically, I think this is a good place to wrap this up. I've been going for nearly 2 hours now, and I think I've really covered everything I need to cover in terms of the basics of getting going. Once you meet other species, pay attention to what their traits are. If they're xenophobes, then, you know, if they're militaristic xenophobes, or hegemonistic, I don't know how you say that exactly, empire builders, you know, they're much more likely to go to war with you than if they are sort of spiritualist xenophiles, for instance. So I'll give you that bit of advice. Pay attention to traits in terms of knowing what to expect from other species. But for now, I think that's it. We're going to wrap this up. I may do a Stellaris series at some point, but honestly, I just want to play it more and to understand the mechanics a lot more before I start doing a playthrough on stream. But there's plenty of other people doing playthroughs. And as I said at the very top of the video, there is going to be a proper review where I talk about what I think about this game, where it falls down, how it compares to Master of Orion, and how it compares to previous Paradox titles. So stay tuned for that. So hopefully you found this informative and interesting, and it's given you some idea of how to start things off with Stellaris. And if you have, you can hit that like button. You can leave any comments below. You can sub to my channel if you aren't already. And as always, stay tuned for more.